Let's open this up to questions from the audience.
I would
Jan, I see Jan Vorberger has raised his hand. Go ahead.
All right. Cheers, Attila. Yes, thank you very much. A very interesting talk. My background is not so much wave function method, but rather say, you know, warm lens matter and thermodynamic Green's function, so quantum electrodynamics. And I have a bit of a trouble understanding what is really meant by exact exchange, if I may. Obviously exchange, you know, there are several orders of you know, several different diagrams, if I, you know, remember from quantum electrodynamics. Could you, is there a way of, you know, relating the expression you've shown for exact exchange, you know, to what one usually understands from perturbation theory and quantum electrodynamics and other places in terms of, I mean, is it really exact, or do you just make several certain terms of exchange, you know, qualitatively and quantitatively better in your procedure?
Okay, what I mean, this of course is a question of definition. If we go back to the let's go to this view graph, we have our cone sham system, which by construction is the ground state of a artificial non-interacting system that has the same electron density as our true ground state wave function. And then in cone sham, what is defined as exchange is if you take this this wave function that comes from this cone sham determinant that comes from a non-interacting Hamiltonian, and you evaluate the electron-electron interaction with this wave function, and you subtract the simple Hartree term, then what's left is in the cone sham formalism, by definition, is exchange. Everything that goes beyond that, by definition, is correlation. You can also do it if you look at this perturbation theory or look at this adiabatic connection. In an adiabatic connection, you go smoothly from the non-interacting system to the fully interacting one. So what you do is you introduce this coupling strength parameter. I called it alpha, sometimes it's called lambda. That would mean I put in front of the electron-electron interaction a factor lambda that goes from 0 to 1. And I always have to change the external potential such that the electron density is always, the ground state electron density is the same. In this way, I have a parameter, lambda or alpha, that switches on the electron-electron interaction from completely non-interacting to the fully interacting one. And if I do this, I can, of course, do perturbation theory with respect to this lambda, to this switching on parameter of the electron-electron interaction. And then Hartree plus exchange, they, by definition, are the linear term. Those that are linear in the coupling strength parameter, this is equivalent in definition in cone sham, is what's called exact exchange. I mean, exchange plus Hartree, you just take the classical electrostatic expression and subtract it from the first order electron-electron interaction. All higher order terms then are by definition in cone sham correlation.
Oh, okay, so the linear term in this charging parameter.
Yes, the linear term in the scaling parameter of the electron-electron interaction.
Okay.
This is what's called, it's a question of definition. Indeed, there has been a long discussion in the literature whether the true exchange potential can be a local potential, local multiplicative, or has to be a non-local potential like in Hartree-Fock. This is an ill-defined discussion because it's a matter of definition. In Hartree-Fock, the exchange potential is a nonlinear operator. And in Cohn-Sham, by definition, it's a functional derivative, so it is linear. So you cannot say one is correct or incorrect. It matters what you want to define or what is your theory. And in Cohn-Sham, it's the functional derivative, so to speak, of the first order energy in the electron-electron interaction, and then you have what's called the sum of Hartree plus exchange potential. If you subtract the Hartree part, then you have exchange.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Tobias, for the question.
Yeah, thank you. So I have a bit of a conceptual question. If you had the exact Cohn-Sham orbitals and so to say the exact Cohn-Sham potential, what would then be the physical meaning of the Cohn-Sham response function? So would it describe the response of a real system, or and what would be the difference to the, let's say, real response function of the system?
It would be exactly the parts that come from so it's a good point. Let's start from our completely non-interacting system. And then, of course, the response function is simply I change this effective potential here. And I ask, how does then the electron density change? But of course, then I have to, what I typically have in practice is I do not have the effective potential, but I have some external potential in my real system. For example, I take in dipole approximation, electromagnetic radiation or whatever. So I have some external potential change to the real system. And what I then need is I need the corresponding change in my effective potential. My effective potential is always, this is on the next one here, is always the external potential, but then also the Hartree potential, the exchange, and the correlation potential. And they depend on the electron density. So if I change the true external potential, this will change the electron density. And then, however, if the electron density changes, obviously the Hartree potential changes, the exchange potential changes, and I need all those changes together to get the corresponding change in the effective potential. And this is exactly why you need their functional derivatives of these potentials with respect to the electron density if you do time-dependent DFT. Because of course the starting point is you have an external, you have a perturbation of your interacting, of your physical system. But you want to calculate the change of the density in the Cohn-Sham system, because this is what you can treat, because there the electrons are decoupled. But the price is that you then need the corresponding change of the effective potential. And this you get if you know the functional derivatives of those quantities here with respect to the electron density, then you can put this all together and solve for the change of the effective potential. And this is then what gives you this Dyson type equation of time dependent DFT, which we had here. This is the Cohn-Sham response, the response of the non-interacting system, but you have to put it together with the change of the Hartree, the exchange and the correlation potential. This is, so to speak, that why you need time-dependent DFT here. And this is a relation between the response of the Cohn-Sham system and the true system. If you just take the response of your Cohn-Sham system to an external potential, then you don't get the correct change of the physical system, because in the Cohn-Sham system, you then have also to see what the effect of the change of the Hartree, the exchange, the correlation potential is.
Okay, thank you. If I may, I have a bit of a follow-up question. Are there any exact analytical constraints known about this exchange correlation kernel?
There are some scaling relations, and there are some relations concerning the asymptotic behavior. But I would say so far it's these kernels are a bit of a, there are some approximations and work is done on them, but most I would say is, is a bit of black box and sometimes almost voodoo-like, that things are tried, they work. And of course, what you can do immediately, but then there is no frequency, is what's called the adiabatic approximation. Of course, if you have a standard GGA density potential, then you can take the derivative. But of course, this object is frequency dependent, and this gets lost in this way. Then it's a straightforward thing. If you have a functional, I mean, you have your energy functional, you take the derivative of with respect to the electron density to get the potential, and then you take the next derivative. But this is then only valid for the static case, but very often these static kernels, this is what you usually do in time-dependent DFT. In practice, you do an adiabatic approximation. That means you neglect the frequency dependence. But this is clearly a strong approximation. And beyond that, you can do these things I tried to show, that is that you use, I mean, perturbation theory and many body, basically, this is a certain form of many body perturbation theory where you do expansions in the coupling strengths, and then you try to extract and resum quantities to get something out. But again, I mean, you can ask, of course, we just throw out some terms here. You can might then write them in terms of diagrams, and we, like always, we throw them away, and we hope in the end that we can live with it. And so constructing these kernels is a really, yeah, I would say, challenging thing.
Yeah, so we have also thought about this in principle. I mean, what we have is in principle the exchange correlation kernel for a uniform electron gas, like local field correction is what we would call it, but it's basically the same quantity. So have you ever thought about using maybe the kernel from a uniform electron gas?
No, this is what we heavily are doing. I mean, I did not talk about this, but we have been working on the homogeneous electron gas for years now. And of course you can use in the homogeneous electron gas, you also, I mean, this thing has very various names. I mean, it's sometimes called H, also in our own work, before we realized that we can express it in some ways, but it was used already 50 years ago, starting from Hartree-Fock, starting from the non-interacting system, which in the homogeneous electron gas, the nice thing is you know the Kohn-Sham system. It's just a constant potential and it's plane waves. So there you have the exact potential, you have the exact Kohn-Sham wave functions and orbitals, and it's known how this quantity, this quantity looks, and you can then use this to calculate the direct RPA or direct RPA with exact exchange. This has been done also by Maria Hellgren and others, and we have codes to do this as well. But in the homogeneous electron gas, if you do the exact Hartree plus exchange kernel, you can only go up to a certain RS value, so around 10. So if you start to make your system no longer dense, but go to the low density limit relatively soon, you get singularities and you cannot go on simply with the Hartree plus exchange kernel. But you can do things like this, and this is something we have been working on, but we are still not really satisfied. I mean, we can get the energy of the homogeneous electron gas as accurate as we want by using certain types of functions here, but then we don't get other quantities like the correlation, like the correlation hole or like the structure factor very, very good. So getting more or less everything good is something which we so far could not reach to a way that we are satisfied. The nice thing in the homogeneous electron gas is, of course, in the high density limit, you only need the leading term. So RPA with exchange is exact in the high density limit of the homogeneous electron gas. And this you can really, I mean, numerically, we can show this. We have been fighting years with the numerics, because if you want to do this really accurate and to evaluate these Hartree and exchange kernel very accurately, then it's numerically not that easy. We now have this under control, but we still, with what we can construct as functionals, we are not really that happy so far with this. This is why we have not yet published anything on that.
So in principle, we could compare your results for the kernel obtained by the formalism to our quantum Monte Carlo results. And the quantum Monte Carlo results would then not only be some kind of energy, but I mean, it would be wave number result in principle, at least at some finite temperatures, let's say around the Fermi temperature, we can also have it like really frequency dependent. So that would be very interesting, I think.
Okay, there we have to say in the moment we can do these parts of the second part of the talk. We have not, this is something on our list, but we have not yet done it. We have not included non-zero temperatures. So here we have only, we have lots of kind of preliminary and intermediate results for energy curves, for like the on top value of the correlation hole and all sorts of things, but it's all, and for all densities, I mean, going from the extreme high density limit to the extreme low density limit, this we can all do, but it's all zero temperature in the moment.
Okay.
And it's not for, there are some basic questions in the generalization of this to finite temperatures. It is a bit, it has to do, in the moment we are integrating along purely imaginary frequency that does things very nicely and simplifies things, but this only works for zero temperature. So we would have to do some other path in the complex frequency plane, but this then has other technical problems. So that is something where we still struggle to do finite temperatures, which would be kind of an obvious thing to do.
Thank you.
Do you think if you did this at finite temperature, would it have consequences for the first example you showed on topological insulators? Is that something you're planning to apply this to? Or?
Well, I mean, the exchange, of course, this is straightforward, the temperature dependence. But what we did along these lines in solids, we calculated, again, at zero temperature, band gaps within the direct random phase approximations. They are very similar to GW results. But and in principle, one could also do these sigma functionals. This is almost trivial to implement them in solids. I mean, it's always trivial if you have already a direct RPA code, which we have in our own, so to speak, big experimental code, but also in something like WASP, you have a direct RPA. So we could immediately put in these sigma functionals. But going beyond, but Banhuis has to be honest, in whenever you're in plain wave codes, all these methods where implicitly you need some kind of Green's functions in your, I mean, if you look at these sum over state expressions, which let's say, for example, here, okay, if you rewrite this in a complex way, then this together with some of these sums are always Green's functions you have, one particle Green's functions. And the problem with that in a solid state code is it makes, you cannot, I mean, in a molecular code with Gaussian functions, you can do these summations relatively easy explicitly. If you would want to do this in plane waves, the ratio of occupied to unoccupied orbital is much more unfavorably. It's maybe a factor 1 to 10 in a molecule, or but 1 to 100 or something in a plane wave code. And everything you do beyond a standard GGA in a plane wave code becomes immediately very, very expensive. I mean, we're doing a lot of applied work where we necessarily treat big systems, slabs with 1,000 atoms. But if you want to do this even with a hybrid functional, it's probably, we cannot do this. And going to these Green's functions constructions, then it becomes, I mean, more or less impossible. I mean, the VAS people, Georg Kresse, often shows results with RPA, and he thinks this is the future. And he has more accuracy. And there, I think these sigma functionals are very interesting because they will be even more accurate. But to be honest, I mean, we always use VASP in practical things, but we never can use our own methods there because it's simply too expensive. I mean, in particular, if you then maybe there do ab initio MD, if you want, then this, and you will have then a system with even 100 or 200 of, atoms for a normal GGA is already expensive, but doing these things, it's a bit a pity, but the nice thing is in molecules, it's relatively efficient. Of course, there are all sorts of things you can do the Sternheimer constructions of the Green's function. There are all sorts of tricks. So one can improve this. I mean, I talked with Georg Kresse, and he thinks his RPA is extremely efficient, and he can do it also for larger systems. But okay, our experience so far is, yeah, he certainly has a very clever implementation and reduced the effort enormously, but it's still extremely expensive. Okay, and this is why we're in the moment a bit reluctant. So in the moment we are working mostly either on molecules or on the homogeneous electron gas. But in principle, all these methods also work for solids. There is no general problem.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Is there other more questions from the audience? Actually, Tim is raising his hand.
Hi. On the subject of the temperature-dependent exact exchange, you showed these results where the band structure kind of qualitatively changes compared to, say, LDA. Mm-hmm. And now, recently, there's a few of these like temperature parameterized local density approximations. Have you considered looking at whether those reproduce some of the effects of temperature-dependent exact exchange, or do you think they would have some impact that would make the curves more similar?
We have not looked at all into this, so I cannot really tell you anything on that. For us, this is more, I mean, we looked in, we did a little bit work on these topological insulators, just because we wanted to do something with our non-zero temperature time exact exchange code, but it's not something we're doing on a regular basis. So I have not too much experience, and I cannot really say how. I mean, if you have something where you have some kind of explicit temperature in your functional, then you probably have a chance to do things. The problem with these GGAs or LDA is just, I mean, if you just have a little change of the electron density due to temperature, in particular, if you go, let's say, from 10, from 50 to 100 to 300 Kelvin, this is, I mean, the occupation numbers remain all small, because, I mean, 100 Kelvin is almost nothing in compared to the energy scale you're working on. So it's very hard to get by the indirect effect through the density anything. And there, so to speak, these direct effects, if you have the in your functional direct temperature dependent, this I think is the only chance how you can get something. But I'm not really an expert in modeling this in any other way, because we never tried. We came more from the other side. We had these exact exchange, and then we wanted to do with something with it.
Okay, sure. Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much. If there aren't any other questions, I'd like to thank Andreas again. Thanks for being here and giving the talk.